All right. Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining. And today we're going to discuss troubleshooting, configuration, and auto discover. And my name is Jim Arndt. I am a senior support escalation engineer in the Charlotte office with a focus on Exchange client connectivity. And my specialties include Active Sync, Auto Discover, and FreeBusy. So, or welcome to the webcast. So for our agenda today, we're going to discuss briefly Outlook configuration and the process of setting up an Outlook profile. We're going to talk about what is Auto Discover, what it is, and what role it plays in Outlook. Talk about troubleshooting the Outlook configuration in Auto Discover, and we'll talk a little bit about auto mapping. So the first thing we're going to talk about is Outlook. And for Outlook, we've got a little bit of a we're going to talk about. So we're part of a company, and our email address is fabriccam2.info. We just signed up for an Office 365 account, and that domain is fabriccam2.onmicrosoft.com. We don't want our users to use that email address. We've configured it so everybody uses just the fabriccam2.info. We created some new mailboxes, and now we're trying to set up Outlook to access those mailboxes. So we logged into machine, and now we're trying to configure Outlook. And when we do that, we, of course, just simply launch Outlook for the first time. And we get a nice Welcome to Outlook window. We click Next. And then we get asked if we want to add an email account. We simply say yes again and click Next. And then we're asked for some account information. Now, if we had Exchange installed in the local Active Directory environment, this information would be automatically populated via an LDAP request made by the client. But in this scenario, we don't have Exchange on-premise. It is only, we're using purely Office 365, so we need to enter in our name, and email address, and password. And keep in mind here that when we do this, the email address we type is what is being used as the username. So then when we click on Next, we get a window that it's searching for our mail server settings. And there's three steps in this process. The first step establishes a network connection. This step almost never fails. The second step is where it actually goes out and searches for the mailbox settings for the user. And then once the client has the settings, it attempts to connect using those settings, using either Outlook Anywhere or Mappy over HD, depending on what was returned. But for this webcast, we're going to focus on that second step, where it's searching for user settings. And we're going to talk about why it fails and some of the steps for troubleshooting it. And it's important to know that this second step utilizes AutoDiscover. And so we're going to talk about what AutoDiscover does. And it simply automatically configures the user profile settings for either Outlook for Windows, Outlook for Mac, and even ActiveSync devices. On top of that, it also provides access to Exchange features for Outlook. So anytime you're using Outlook and you try to change your out-of-office message, or you're trying to meeting, that's using, and it can via AutoDiscover. So since this is an contact AutoDiscover, so to locate AutoDiscover, there are two methods. The first is via a service connection point. In this, a client performs an LDAP query to locate service connection objects within Active Directory. And this has two requirements. And First being the client needs to be connected to a corporate network, and second, Exchange is installed in that Active Directory forest. So since our scenario, we don't have Exchange local, we're not going to focus at all today on the service connection point. We're simply going to look at the second method, which is DNS. How does EPC use DNS? Well, it takes the email address that we entered, and it uses the SMTP domain to perform DNS queries. The first query we'll try is looking for an A record for the SMTP domain. So in this example, fabricam2.info. After that, if needed, it would look to a DNS query for an A record or a CNAME for autodiscover.yoursmtp domain. So autodiscover.fabricam2.info here. I want to make note here, the recommendation that we have for Office 365 is to configure a CNAME record for autodiscover for your domain to point to autodiscover.outlook.com. And we'll go into that a little bit more here in a little bit. And then the third DNS record that can possibly be looked up is an SRV lookup for underscore autodiscover dot underscore TCP dot the SMTP domain. And here's a link for the external DNS records required for Exchange Online. And with these DNS queries, the client will generate HTTP requests based on the results. So the first request would be HTTPS, the SMTP domain, /autodiscover/autodiscover.xml. If that one fails, then it does does HTTPS, autodiscover.thedomain. And then the third is HTTP. This we're trying over port 80. And this one is highlighted because this is the method we expect to succeed with an Office 365 mailbox. And then the last method would be HTTPS to whatever host name was returned in that SRV lookup. So in this example, I have mail.smtp domain. And the reason we want to use that third one, the HTTP, is we want the connection to be secure. We want to use SSL because we're passing credentials. But in Office 365, we have a large number of domains, and the server cannot have a certificate for each of those tenant domains. So we have everyone come in to an HTTP, and they will get a redirect to an HTTPS. And I'll cover that here on the next slide as we discuss the process flow. So the first one, of course, is just, for our example, HTTPS, fabricam2.info. We expect that connection to fail, and the client then attempts HTTPS autodiscover. If we configured our CNAME record properly, DNS should resolve to autodiscover.outlook.com, and we should just fail that connection on 443. Then when the client attempts HTTP, we should get a redirect address of HTTPS autodiscover-s.outlook.com, and the dash s is just for secure. And we should have a request that is sent to autodiscover-s.outlook.com, which then actually returns another redirect address to one of the pod servers in the service. And then when we attempt to that URL, we should get our settings back for our mailbox. So this is just a brief overview of autodiscover, how it's discovered, and the process flow. So now we'll talk about how do we troubleshoot autodiscover and the profile creation. There are some tools we can use. Some of the tools are going to be for our basic DNS name resolution and web traffic. Can we browse to these URLs from the client? We'll also talk about the Exchange Remote Connectivity Analyzer. This is an external tool that allows us to test autodiscover. Talk about a tool called Fiddler. It is a web proxy that allows us to view the autodiscover requests and responses. And then we'll talk about some of the Outlook features and how they can be used to troubleshoot. So the first step in troubleshooting is, since this is AutoDiscover and it's using DNS, the first thing we should do is verify that we can actually resolve the names. We know which names we're looking at. So let's verify name resolution and then verify that we can connect to those URLs from the client. And as we just discussed, there's three possible DNS records that we could query for. The A record for fabricam2.info, this A record CNAME for AutoDiscover, and the SRV. And you know, for this scenario, we really would want to focus on that second one, the CNAME. So for testing DNS, we can just go to the command prompt and use the native NS lookup and ping command. And you may be wondering, well, why do I have ping on there? Having been in support for many years, you learn that what NS lookup returns, the client doesn't always use. There's a local host file in the client that sometimes gets populated for other troubleshooting reasons that breaks the name resolution. So here in this command prompt window, you can see there in the middle, we did a NS lookup for AutoDiscover of fabricam2.info, which returned a 111.221 address. But then below that, when it was a ping command was executed, it returned a 192.168 address. And we can simply go in and look for a host file. We would probably find that entry in the host file. So once we verify the DNS resolution is working properly and as expected, we need to make sure that we don't have any HTTP connection issues. And we can do this by opening up any web browser and attempting to browse to the URL. And as you can see here, we have a page cannot be displayed. One of the most common reasons for this is a proxy server. So we can look at the proxy server settings. And if you're using Internet Explorer, you can just go to the settings icon and select Internet options. It'll bring up a list of tabs. If you go to the connections tab and LAN settings, that'll bring up the proxy server settings. Now, some proxy servers, they'll do a deep packet inspection of the HTTPS traffic, and we've seen this alter the AutoDiscover request, causing failures. So we recommend, if possible, to bypass the proxy server when connecting to an Office 365 resource. And there is a TechNet article that provides a list of IP addresses for the service. So right now, I want to do a quick demo on another common issue seen with DNS. To do that, to my remote desktop session, which, so give me 1 second to reconnect. All right. So here I'm logged in my domain as a user. And if I were to do an NS lookup for autodiscover.fabricam2.info, see here I get a name cannot be found. And up here in the address, we can see our DNS server. Well, I know when I set all this up, I created an external DNS record. I followed the TechNet article. This DNS server here is an internal DNS server. I'm logged into my fabricam2.info domain. If I go to my domain controller, we also have a DNS zone for that same here. We call this split brain DNS. When internal and external DNS, we have external and internal DNS for the same domain name. So to make this work, I would have to also create a record internally for AutoDiscover and point it to that autodiscover.outlook.com. And now when I do my DNS query, I should get back some records. And now I should be able to browse to that URL. And when you browse, typically if you get prompted for credentials, you should know that it is resolving properly and connecting. And then if you put in your credentials, you should get an invalid request, a 600 error message. And we can't connect over 443, so that won't work here. But you could do the HTTP and get a redirect. That's back to PowerPoint. So like I said, that is just another common issue in the split brain DNS scenario where the CNAME is missing in the internal DNS. The second tool is the Exchange Remote Connectivity Analyzer. This is a website that allows you to test AutoDiscover and other various ELO connectivity features from an external resource. So if there is some issue internally in your network, using this tool will test it from an outside source. So if it's successful from this tool, we know that this Office 365 service is functioning as expected. We need to investigate something internal. And it's also nice because when you do the test, it gives you a full process flow of what the tool is testing. So it'll show you the DNS resolution. It'll show you it verifying the certificate and all the steps. And then if there are any errors, you normally can see a descriptive error within the results. And oftentimes, there is a tip on how to resolve it. So I provided a couple of slides, an overview of what it looks like. And you can see there's an Office 365 tab. And down in here, you could select the Outlook AutoDiscover. And then when you perform, it will ask for the email address, the Microsoft account, the username, and password. And of course, there's the verification. It wants to verify you're a human and not a computer. And then on the test, you can see it stepping through. It'll give a progress. And then when it completes, you'll get either a success with warnings, or an error. And we're going to do this real quick so you can see what a failed test looks like and some of the information you can get out of it. So I'm just going to bounce back over to my client. You can go to exrca.com. That is a shortcut URL. The full URL is actually testconnectivity.microsoft.com. Exrca is a little bit easier to remember. So I'm going to do an Outlook AutoDiscover test. And here I'm going to put my email address, what I think it is. And I know my username is and my password. And I love these verification codes. Well, a few times I got it right on the first try. And this just takes a minute to run through. You can see, and even in here, it updates every few seconds to let you know what it's actually trying at the time. So since we're just doing AutoDiscover, it's just showing AutoDiscover. If you did Outlook connectivity, the Outlook connectivity test will actually do an AutoDiscover test to retrieve the settings to test the Outlook connection, or you can manually specify. So here we can see our test failed. So normally what I do is I click the expand all. It's easiest. That way I can just scroll down. And here you can see it tells you how long the entire test took. And here we can see it's trying the fabricam2.info. just our SMTP domain first. And we expect that to fail. So I'm just going to minimize those steps, and now it's trying the HTTPS to auto-discover. We also expect that to fail, and we can see that it does, and a network error occurred. So now we can see the third is the HTTP redirect. This is where we're just doing HTTP to auto-discover. And here we can see this was successful, and here is our redirect. So we're being redirected to the auto-discover-S. And now it's trying the auto-discover-S, resolves the name. Here we can see now it's testing the SSL cert. And then after it does that, it attempts to post to the auto-discover URL. And here we this. I'm sorry. We get another redirect to the pod. And then the pod does the post to the service. And we have an error. We have a 500 error. The email address can't be found. And I purposely put in the wrong email address for this so that you could see an error message. And this one is very descriptive. We know the email address is wrong. So either the user thinks their email address is something it isn't, or they don't have an email address associated with their mailbox. So to resolve this, I could either add the email address for that mailbox or let the user know that, no, your email address is really just jim@fairbankm2.info. The third tool, and one of the best tools for troubleshooting inside the network, is Fiddler. Fiddler is a web debugging proxy that allows you to debug web traffic from just about any device. So if you're using Outlook for Mac, for example, you could install Fiddler on a Windows PC and set it up to accept connections from remote computers and set up the Mac to use the PC as a proxy. And you could actually capture the web traffic from the Mac and capture the auto-discover traffic. It also works for ActiveSync. So with a mobile phone, you can do the same thing. And what's nice is because it's a proxy, you can decrypt the HTTPS traffic. It'll install a self-signed cert for that purpose. And because it decrypts the HTTPS traffic, we can view the XML response and requests from the client. To set Fiddler up, after you install it, you just go to the Tools and Fiddler Options and go to the HTTPS tab, and there's an option there to decrypt HTTPS traffic. Now, when you do this, it is going to install a certificate to act as a man in the middle, and that's what allows this tool to decrypt the SSL traffic. So it's going to alert you of that. You need to say yes to use this feature. And then when you do, Windows is also going to warn you that you're about to install a certificate. Once you're done troubleshooting with this tool, you can always go back and remove these certificates. Highly recommend that you do that. And after you set that, you launch Outlook and go through those same steps, you would see the auto-discover traffic as you do here. And now we'll just go ahead and take a look at this live. So I'll launch Fiddler. And then Tools and Fiddler Options. Here's where you set the, just making sure it's decrypted. And then when you're all done, you can click on the Remove Certificates. And now I'll go ahead and launch Outlook. And I'll put in my information. And here we can see those same steps taking place. Now it's prompting me for my password. Remember, it's using the email address that I put in there. And since I put in a bad email address, it's not going to work. I'll just go ahead and update my credentials. Can't do it via a method, so we'll just go ahead and hit next. And it failed. So now, over here in Fiddler, we can see these five errors. It can't connect on 443 to fabricam2.info or AutoDiscover. Then we can see the 302 redirect. And if we go to the headers for the response, we can see the redirect URL. And of course, the next thing we see is the tunnel to AutoDiscover-S. And in AutoDiscover-S, we can see the redirect to the pod server. And now, traffic for the pod server, we can see in here, it looks no redirect, and actually we can see an Exchange backend server. So those that know Exchange, we know this server went to a mailbox server to retrieve the settings. What we can do now is we can go to the XML tab. And here in the XML tab, we can see that same 500 error code we saw with the remote connectivity analyzer. And once again, the email address can't be found. So very useful tool. Here, we have no idea what failed, but using Fiddler, we know we had a bad email address. So now if I go in here and just change my email address and click retry, it should complete successfully. Now I just go back. There we can see the second check is green, so we know AutoDiscover was successful. And then the third one connecting to the mailbox. And if you look in here, you can see the slash mappy. That's it doing the test connection to the mailbox, and it's using mappy over HTTP. So by using Fiddler, I was able to find out that I was using bad email address and was able to set up my Outlook. So I'll go ahead and go back to our slides. So just like we saw in the demo, we now have the three green checkboxes. So hopefully using one or more of those tools, we're able to figure out why Outlook wasn't able to set up the initial profile. But back in the list of tools, I also had Outlook listed as a troubleshooting tool. Well, we can't use Outlook to troubleshoot the initial profile creation. Yes, we can turn on Outlook logging, but that creates a binary file that you need support to decode to figure out. But we can use Outlook after the profile is set up. Things change over time. Something causes configurations to break. So even though your profile is set up, maybe you can't view free busy any longer, or you can't set your out of office. All those features leverage AutoDiscover to get the URLs to make those Exchange web service calls. With Outlook, there's a test email auto configuration tool. Does the same thing that the Exchange remote connectivity analyzer tool does. And you can use that to test and make sure that AutoDiscover is working properly. And another feature of Outlook is the local XML. The local XML is just cached AutoDiscover response. And I'll talk about that a little bit more here in a second. But first, the test auto configuration tool, you just control and right click on the Outlook icon in the toolbar and you'll get this window. And of course, we need to enter in our email address and password manually. We also want to uncheck the two use guest mark options and then click test. And then it'll run through the test, and if it's successful, you would see something like this. If there's errors, you would get unable to determine your settings error message. Normally, when I run this tool, I go straight to the log tab. The log tab will show you the process flow, just like we saw with Remote Connectivity Analyzer. And the XML tab that you see on the screen, that would show you the XML response. if it was successful. The local file that I was talking about, this is a hidden file located in the user's profile under the app data local Microsoft Outlook folder. And it is, of course, used when auto-discover fails. Each service of Exchange, auto-discover, Exchange Web Services, Outlook Anywhere, those applications run separately on Exchange. So if one has a service outage, it doesn't affect another feature. So maybe something's only wrong with auto-discover. We don't want FreeBusy to fail. We don't want your ability to set the out-of-office to not work just because of auto-discover. So to prevent that, we cache the auto-discover response into this local XML file that Outlook will use in reference. So if you're having problems with everything and you don't see any auto-discover traffic, it could be just using this XML file, and maybe the XML file gets bad. You can always delete it and let it regenerate a new one. Or if you see it going to, you see web traffic going to the wrong site, it could be because it's using XML because auto-discover is not working. This is more just a way to determine what it got as a previous response and as an explanation of why it might be misbehaving now. And you can safely delete this at any time and let it be regenerated. So I just want to quickly show the test email auto-configuration. So I'd go back here since it is running. And down here in the toolbar, if you just control right-click, there's the option to test email auto-configuration. And uncheck those and then put in your information. Like I said, I always bounce over. You can see, even though I'm running test email config, Fiddler in the background is once again performing the query or logging the queries. And we can see we failed to recover. Now we're trying to redirect. We're getting all our calls. And then this last line succeeded with the 8 zeros. It's complete. And if the XML tab, I see the response. Inside this response, you can see all of our settings. So since it's using MAPI over HTTP, we can see the URLs used to connect to that. And if we scroll down further under the EXHTTP, we can see the Exchange Web Services URL. This is the URL that we're using for FreeBusy and OOF. And I'm going to stop the capture. All right. And the last thing I want to talk today about is auto-mapping. There are times when users need to access multiple mailboxes, whether it's the users that need to access a shared mailbox, or if it's an admin assistant that needs to also have access to an executive's mailbox. There are instances where they need multiple. And auto-mapping automatically adds mailboxes to a user's Outlook profile that they have full access to. So before auto-mapping, a user would have to go into their account settings and then click the Change button, click the More settings, and then they'd have the option here to add additional mailboxes. And they can add multiple mailboxes through here, and then when they're done, it would be visible in their Outlook. But how do you add an archive mailbox? Suppose you have an archive for messages older than 365 days, whatever your retention policy settings are. How would you add that through here manually? It's not in the address book. You can't find it anywhere to add it. And the archive mailbox also uses the auto map feature. So whether the mailbox is being added via auto mapping or they did it manually, this is how it would look in Outlook. Underneath the user's main mailbox, they would see the additional mailbox. There's no way from this screen to know how that mailbox was added. If it was auto-mapped, if you went back through those account settings, you would see that list empty. Then you would know it was auto-mapped. How does this mailbox get in there automatically? That is done via auto-discover. So when you look at the auto-discover response, you'll see an alternative mailbox with a type of delegate for every user that they have full access. And then if it's an archive mailbox, the alternative mailbox type would be archive. And then in there, the SMTP address you can see is pretty ugly. We want to add that manually. So we would find one or both of those in the auto-discover response. So I'm just going to go back to my client real quick, and I'm going to show you these because look at my Outlook. You will see that I do have an online archive, and I do have Zeek's mailbox showing in my Outlook. So I didn't show earlier with Fiddler to help you out when you have a large trace like this. So if you click this Find button, you can type auto-discover, and it will highlight only your auto-discover requests. So here I have for the pod. And in here I can see my XML response. Then if I scroll down my response, here I can see my archive mailbox coming in my response, and below that my delegate. And one thing I didn't mention was public folders, but it'll also show you public folder information for the new public folder mailbox in Exchange Online. And then what you will also notice, if you have Fiddler running, that only gives you the email address. So we still perform an auto-discover query for these mailboxes. So if Fiddler open and you continue to capture, if you look here, you'll see in this request, there's the GUID of my archive mailbox. And then down here in the response, you can see the in-place archive for my mailbox and the settings on how to connect to it. So even though it's in the auto-discover response for mine, it's just telling me information about that I have other mailboxes. It doesn't tell me how to connect. A separate auto-discover query can be made for those. Here's the public folder. And that's me again. There should be another one in here for Zeek. But you can see how auto-discover works and provides these auto-map mailboxes. So even though everything else is working, you were able to configure your profile, maybe now you were granted full access to the mailbox, but you don't see it. These tools can also be used to help you troubleshoot and figure out why those shared mailboxes or archive mailboxes are not appearing. Here are some resources from what I covered today.